Jeremiah Coghlan was born in Crookhaven in southwest Cork, Ireland. He was born in the late 1770s, with his exact date of birth being unknown, though it's speculated that he was born in 1779. Much of his early life is surrounded in mystery, and even the details of his later life can be obscure, despite his naval achievements being widely reported. Some accounts suggest he grew up as a friendless orphan. Others claim that he ran away from home to escape the cruelty of his mother. In any case, he made his way to sea as a cabin boy on a merchant sloop. Yet, while in Neath, a town in Wales, he deserted due to the captain's brutality. Eventually, he was found and taken before a magistrate. Fortunately, he faced no consequences and soon found work as a bricklayer. However, he soon realised that this wasn't the life for him. Shortly after this, again he found work as a cabin boy, this time aboard a ship bound for Plymouth. While en route, the ship became stranded on some rocks near Mevergizzy, Cornwall, during a bad storm. A man by the name of Captain Smith saw the vessel and immediately commandeered a fishing boat to save the crew. The rescue was a success, but as they made their way to shore, the crew realised that they had forgotten the cabin boy. Captain Smith insisted on returning. He found young Jeremiah clinging with terror to the fore topmast. Captain Smith then climbed the mast and saved his life. On the 26th of January 1796, the Dutton East Indiaman ran aground under the citadel in Plymouth during a storm. The vessel had almost 500 people still on board, all of whom needed saving. Yet, due to the raging storm, hardly anyone dared venture out. As the ship sank, a crowd gathered and watched helplessly. Among those present in the crowd was none other than Coghlan, who was said to have been only 16 at the time. This event marked the beginning of his naval career, but the role he played in the rescue mission during the storm is debated due to varying stories. Some accounts allege that he plunged into the raging sea, carrying a lifeline. Even though he could have easily died if he crashed into the rocks, apparently he was successful in saving several lives. Others state he brought a boat out to the wreck and proceeded to save no less than 50 men. Other versions claim that he was on a merchant vessel and with the aid of volunteers, managed to save 100 frightened wretches. Yet, in the reports immediately after the disaster, there's no mention of Coghlan or his heroic actions. Whatever the truth behind these events, in the end, only 15 lives were lost, and Coghlan's bravery must have been noticed by Captain Edward Pellew. Well, he was so impressed by Coghlan's conduct that he offered him a place on his own ship, the Indefatigable. Not only this, but he promised him a promotion to the quarterdeck. Coghlan came aboard the Indefatigable on the 29th of July, 1796. After 3 years, he transferred to the HMS Impetuo, alongside his friend and patron, Captain Edward Pellew. It was at this stage of his career that he earned the nickname Intrepid Jerry. Not only had he distinguished himself many times, but he would frequently save the lives of clumsy crew members who fell overboard. Finally, in the year 1800, Coghlan was finally given command of a vessel. This was an award for his gallantry and ability. The Admiral, Lord Vincent, appointed him as acting lieutenant of the 12-gun cutter called Viper. Coghlan was feeling cheerful, positive, and eager for adventure. He soon planned an ambitious expedition during a blockade off Port Louis on the south coast of Brittany. Coghlan came up with the idea of taking control of one of the gunboats that guarded the entrance to the harbour. The vessel in question was a French gun brig named Cerber. She mounted 3 long 24 and 4 6-pounder guns, with a crew of 86 men, 16 of whom were soldiers. Furthermore, Cerbère was anchored below three batteries. Although taking the brig was no easy task, Coghlan believed it could be done. He persuaded Sir Edward Pellew to lend him the flagship's 10-oared cutter with 12 volunteers. In total, he had a crew of 20 men and the support of two other smaller boats. In the blackness of the night, along with his valiant crew, they set out on this daring adventure. Coghlan's vessel reached Cerbère first. Upon arrival, they saw that the brig was lit with battle lanterns and that it had lots of men on board. Nevertheless, the crew immediately jumped on board, with Coghlan leading the way. Unfortunately, he landed on a trawl net, and while he was trying to free himself, the enemy thrust him through the thigh with a pike. Several of his men also got hurt, but they picked themselves back up, hauled their boat a little further ahead, and again boarded the Cerbère. Yet, once more, the French repelled the attack. However, on their third and final attempt, they succeeded in breaking through the French defences. All the officers were either killed or wounded. In total, 6 men died and 20 were wounded. Coghlan and his crew had captured the brig. The other two boats arrived just as the fight was over and helped tow out the prize under a wrathful fire from the shore batteries. As a result of the conflict, one of Coghlan's men died, and 8 more were wounded, himself included. Sir Edward Pellew presented an account of the events to Lord St. Vincent, the Commander-in-Chief of the Channel Fleet, mentioning his admiration for the crew, as well as the courage and skill of the handful of brave fellows that managed to pull off such a daring enterprise. St. Vincent was, without a doubt, one of the driest and grimmest of admirals. But even he was delighted with Coghlan's exploits. In fact, he was so impressed that he urged His Majesty to authorise an order in council to approve Coghlan's promotion to lieutenant, despite not having completed the necessary time in His Majesty's Navy. Furthermore, he presented him with a handsome gold sword worth 100 guineas. His achievements at Port Louis earned him a reputation as a dashing naval hero. For the next 3 years, he remained in command of the Viper and continued to be successful. Then, in 1803, while the Treaty of Amiens was still in effect, which put a halt to the Napoleonic Wars, he got married to a woman called Isabella Hay. Together they had 2 children, a son named William Marcus, and a daughter called Susan Pellew. With the end of peace in Europe, in 1804, Coghlan returned to active service. He was given the ship, Renard, as well as being promoted to the rank of commander. Coghlan spent the next 6 years in the West Indies, where once again, he was recognised for his valiant and daring actions. On Friday, the 20th of March, 1805, while off the north coast of San Domingo, Coghlan gave chase to a French privateer, General Ernof. The 18-gun corvette was captained by Paul Gerard Pointe and had 160 men on board. After a chase of about 3 hours, Renard managed to close in on the French ship, and the actions commenced. Legend has it that Captain Pointe, upon seeing the inferior size of Renard, called Coghlan to strike. Coghlan is reputed to have taken up his trumpet and replied, "Aye, I'll strike, and damned hard too, my lad, directly." Coghlan waited until the French were within a close range, and then commenced a deadly accurate return of fire. After 35 minutes, the French ship caught on fire, and then blew up with a dreadful explosion. Coghlan immediately ordered his only undamaged boat to be launched to rescue the few brave but unfortunate survivors. He succeeded in rescuing all those that had survived the explosion, but described them as being in a mangled and distressing state. On the 25th of May 1806, Coghlan's ship Renard was about 10 miles northeast of the island Mona. While sailing the seas around the Puerto Rican archipelago, the crew spotted a foreign ship near the island of Desecheo. Coghlan didn't hesitate and immediately ordered his men to chase down the ship. After 2 days, the Renard was finally gaining on the foreign ship, which was discovered to be the French Navy brig Diligent. But it wasn't until noon of the 28th, 3 days after the initial sighting, that the crew got close enough to open fire. However, before any shot was fired, the Diligent's commander surrendered his ship. When the commander was taken on board Renard, he was surprised by the small size of the vessel and requested that he be returned to his ship to continue the fight. Of course, Coghlan laughed at this request. The Frenchman then asked for a certificate stating that he had not acted cowardly. Coghlan replied, "No, I cannot do that, but I will give you one that shall specify you have acted prudently." In November 1810, Coghlan was made a post captain, and 2 years later, he was appointed as flag captain of Admiral Sir Edward Pellew's flagship Caledonia. Despite his position as flag captain, Coghlan continued with his heroics. In August 1813, he led an assault on 5 batteries defending the port of Cassis in the south of France. While under heavy fire, Coghlan, along with 200 marines, managed to overcome a fortified 25-foot wall using only ladders and their strength. Thanks to the gallantry of Coghlan, the marines under his command managed to secure the town. This assault proved very valuable, as the British were able to capture 3 gunboats and 24 merchant vessels. Coghlan continued to serve in the Mediterranean Sea. Then, nearing the end of 1814, he was transferred from the flagship Caledonia to the frigate Alcmene. In May 1815, he was stationed in the Bay of Naples, right as the Neapolitan War was coming to an end. Colahan's vessel, Alcmene, formed part of the squadron that blockaded the port of Naples. He was then influential in the signing of a treaty which permitted the British to gain possession of all the ships in the port of Naples. With the war lost, on the 19th of May, the King of Naples, Murat, fled the city while in disguise. During this time, the city was in chaos. Riots frequently broke out, and it was down to Coghlan and his men to maintain order. Coghlan combined the forces of his marines with the civic guard and was instrumental in keeping the peace until the arrival of Prince Leopold a few days later. In 1826, Coghlan was placed in command of the Fort Frigate on the South America station. While there, he became a senior officer at the Port of Rio in Brazil. In July 1830, after 4 years in South America, he retired from active service. He died in his home in Ryde, on the Isle of Wight, on the 4th of March, 1844, at the age of 69. Despite coming from nothing, at the time of his death, he was a man of considerable wealth. Near the end of his life, his relationship with his wife was a very negative one. Presumably, it had broken down years before. He wrote the following regarding her: "To the wretched woman I am obliged to call my wife, Mrs. Isabella Coghlan, I will and bequeath £1,000 of the aforesaid sum, which in addition to the pension she will receive in case of my death, and which she has forfeited 1,000 times by her abandoned and profligate conduct, is indefinitely more than she deserves." His death and funeral were widely reported in the press. He was remembered for his many virtues, such as his distinguished bravery, intrepidity, firmness, and humanity. He was described as a most excellent and meritorious officer. Thank you everyone for watching this video on Jeremiah Coghlan. If you enjoyed, please leave me a like. If you're new to the channel, why not subscribe? There was quite a lot of controversy about how to say his last name. I went for what I went for. And that's all from me. I'll see all of you in the next Forgotten Lives. Thanks.